maybe some part which you don't understand, so you can always ask me questions regarding that. Okay, so different types of basins that you have already studied them and how they are related to tectonics. Now there is something what we call as basin analysis. And what we do in basin analysis is we carry out comprehensive analysis of the sedimentology. So comprehensive analysis of sedimentology, stratigraphy and tectonics. So all these three, sedimentology, stratigraphy and tectonic context of a study area, because all these processes are interrelated to one another. So you cannot say like sedimentology depends only on tectonics. To an extent, tectonics may also depend on what type of sedimentology you are getting in that area. Can anyone give an example how tectonics, you all know, we all studied how tectonics can influence sedimentology, but can any of you give an example where sedimentology can impact tectonics? Anyone? Just give it a try. Any example? So you already studied that tectonics yeah correct so tectonics influences sedimentation yeah correct so I'm getting your point so this is very easy to visualize but opposite sedimentary influence on tectonics. So as Bhargav said, what did you say again? Can you repeat, Bhargav? One example of. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, correct. So what Bhargav is saying is this weathering and erosion actually can result in removal of the sedimentary load on top, and that may result in isostatic rebound, where if the load is removed, the lithosphere will rise. So it's something like this. So we studied like lithospheric loading, where you had a load and there was a flexural bulge. So this loading itself, we studied one thing was this loading can happen due to sedimentation also. So in one way, this loading is also an influence of sedimentation on tectonics. Another thing is, if you remove this load, this can rebound, so it can go up. So if this was your original position and it has, after removal of this load, it has rebounded. Another example will be, for example, sedimentation can influence tectonics is if you see your this Himalayan mountain belt, you have these different zones here where you have the these different thrusts all along. So you have this STDS, MBT, sorry, MC, first it should be MCT, MBT, and then finally you have MFT, or some people call it HFT also. So what is happening here is at this tectonic, you see Indian monsoon is very strong. So what happens here is due to this rainfall, this frontal here, this the front of the mountain belt, it experiences a lot of erosion. So a lot of material is weathered out and eroded out, and it is taken away. So what that does is it sort of like reduces the load on the top. And what can that do is the metamorphic rocks that you see here, especially in this zone, which is higher Himalayan crystallines. So the rocks in here, because they are getting eroded, this results in exhumation of deeper rocks to the surface. So this is also sort of an example of where climate is influencing and sedimentation is influencing tectonics. So it is not just sedimentation, even climate can induce tectonics. So climate, sedimentation and tectonics are all interlinked. And when So this was an example of Himalayan mountain belt, which is not exactly a sedimentary basin. This is just to illustrate an example that all these processes, sedimentation, tectonics, and climate, are interlinked. So basin analysis will involve a comprehensive study of sedimentology, stratigraphic, and tectonic context of an area. Another thing, it considers all possible controls on formation of a sedimentary succession for a model for sedimentary basin evolution. So all possible controls. So all possible controls will include everything. Tectonics. What will be the possible controls? Tectonics. Your climate. Other thing like geography, etc. All these controls on formation of sedimentary succession for a model of, so you'll build models for sedimentary basin evolutions and you'll consider all possible controls. Study of basin analysis involves understanding origin of sedimentary basins. So important term here is that it involves understanding the origin, how did it originate, and its subsequent evolution and ultimate destruction. So this is a whole cycle of basin evolution. So first you have origin, there will be some tectonic processes that will take place that will result in origin of a sedimentary basin, and through time it will evolve because tectonics is not a constant thing. It will keep on changing and deposition will keep on happening, and overall the structure as well as the stratigraphy of sedimentary basin will evolve through time, and finally the sedimentary basin will be destroyed. For example, if you have a sedimentary basin which is ocean basin, you have already studied those, and you have those strata within ocean basin, how will they get destroyed? So they can be destroyed by subduction process where the sedimentary layers are carried to the mantle and they are destroyed over there. Geological cross-section structures and contour mapping is done for this purpose. So these are very important things. So you need mapping as well as geological cross-sections. These processes can help you identify basin evolution. And what are the three things that you are trying to study within basin evolution? You are trying to study basin fill. So how sediment, so whatever accommodation space or you are creating within a basin, how is it getting filled up? So that will come under basin fill. Basin geometry. What is the shape, overall shape of the basin in three-dimensional scenarios? So it is not just two-dimensional where you look at depth and length. You look all everything. So you look it on three dimensions, the breadth, the length, and the depth. Now this figure illustrates different types of studies or analysis that will be carried out as part of your basin analysis. So most basic of these is your structural analysis. Why is structural analysis important? Because structural analysis will provide you evidence of what type of tectonic setting you are in. So structural analysis will provide you tectonic setting. How? Because structural analysis will aid in understanding the deformation during deposition. So what type of deformation you are seeing? For example, if you see whether it is extensional regime or is it compressional regime, you see structures that provide evidences of all these kind of tectonic settings. So structural analysis will aid in identifying the tectonic setting, but you cannot just rely on structural analysis for identifying tectonic settings. You integrate it with evidences from other areas such as sedimentology, stratigraphy, and then an integrated analysis will provide a proper picture. So that is why you use this. So if this was first one, you use other evidences also. So you carry out sedimentological analysis, which provides information about source of sediment and as well as environment of deposition. So these processes will tell you about things that are playing into role, that play the role in evolution as well as formation of a basin. Now geohistory analysis. What is geohistory analysis? It is basically geological history or the subsidence history. So when you are depositing these layers in a sedimentary basin. Let's say you have deposited these two layers, and to a certain extent, in the initial stages, this basin will keep on subsiding. So then you may have some extra layers during this process. So let's say these were your original layers, and now you may have extra layers within this sedimentary basin. And then there can be some tectonic events also. For example, if this basin gets tilted, so what will happen if this basin gets tilted? It may become something like this. Then all these beds that you have deposited, they also get tilted. So this subsidence history. And what will happen to the new beds that will be deposited? That again, based on principle of original horizontality, they will be all again horizontal. So you form some sort of an unconformity during this event right here. So all this will come under geohistory analysis of a basin, which will cover the subsidence history. Then thermal history. So how is thermal history different from subsidence history? So thermal history, you all know that with depth, the geothermal gradient, and due to geothermal gradient, temperature increases. So you already seeing this layer, for example, this layer A here, it is getting buried under more and more weight. So all this, let's call this as layer A. So it is getting buried under sediments. So what will happen due to the geothermal gradient? So at depth initial, if it is shallow, you will have less temperature. If it gets buried deeper, your temperature increases. And if it gets buried even deeper, your temperature increases further. So this, when you relate the subsidence history and you take into consideration the geothermal gradient in that area, what you will get is you will get a sort of a thermal history. So how is the temperature changing for a given strata as it is buried under more and more weight? So thermal history is related to overall burial history. Then finally, you go to geophysical data, where you will study basin structure and thickness of succession. So what is the overall thickness? So in this process, when you study geophysical data, seismic are extremely important, because seismic section or seismic seismic studies, because a seismic cross section will give you all the evidences of how the basin is evolving. For example, whatever picture you are seeing here, this one right here, so this type of section you will get from seismic studies. Other than seismic, other geophysical tools also come into play in basin analysis, such as gravity surveys. Because gravity surveys, these sedimentary rocks, they have some porosity in them. So the rocks deposited in a sedimentary basin and the area that includes your sedimentary basin, it will have overall lower density compared to surrounding rocks. For example, in this picture, if you see, if this is your basement and these are sedimentary rocks, so sedimentary rocks will have less density compared to basement rocks, which could be igneous or metamorphic. So because they will have less density, so if you carry out gravity surveys, you can identify them. For example, you will have a negative gravity, you can have a negative gravity anomaly in this case. Similarly, you carry out other geophysical surveys also, for example, magnetic surveys, so on. Your electrical. So what these will tell you? These will tell you overall broad dimensions of. So these three here, that is gravity, magnetic and electric survey, will tell you overall dimensions of the sedimentary basin. Whereas seismic studies will give you detailed picture of how this basin has evolved over time. And another part now, after that you go to stratigraphic analysis. Stratigraphic analysis will allow you to I will allow you to study the age of the rocks and correlate them. So for example, this picture you are seeing very nicely here, where you see a nice sedimentary basin. But what when you go to field, not all of this is exposed. Maybe you'll have data from some point A and some data from another point B, which is far away from A. So how do you correlate these rock, these different units that you might see in these areas which are located from further, which are located far apart from one another, or even there might be some areas C here. So that correlation you can carry out by stratigraphic analysis. Within this stratigraphic analysis, you will include mostly litho, bio, as well as lithostratigraphy, bio stratigraphy, sequence stratigraphy is very important. Because sequence stratigraphy involved, these will give you, for example, lithostratigraphy will correlate same rock types, but same rock types could have been deposited at different times. The same is the result for biostratigraphy. Whereas sequence stratigraphy, even if the rock type is different, maybe you have slightly different depositional environment, but sequence stratigraphy can give you timelines, which can be converted into chronostratigraphy. So chronostratigraphy is just time stratigraphy. How is the basin evolving through time? So that is a special significance of sequence stratigraphy in this overall analysis. Okay. So after this basin analysis, we move to what are some of the mapping methods that we use. So we already studied what are two main important tasks that you carry out in basin analysis. One is building maps. So first one was building maps. And second is building cross sections. So what types of maps do we build in basin analysis? So first one is isopach maps. So what do you mean by isopach maps? So these are loci along with total sediment thickness of sedimentary succession remains same. So isopach is nothing but thickness maps. So these will include contours. So these isopachs will include contours. They will look something like this. So what values are you going to have here? For example, you can have different contour lines with different thicknesses, where you can have contours such as, for example, here the thickness could be 500 meters, 600 meters, 700 meters. So you sort of see that thickness in the center is decreasing. So it could be 400 meters here. So these are known as isopach maps. So they include contours which join points of equal thickness. They are nothing but thickness. So these are not depth maps or elevation topographic maps that you have seen. So they are thickness maps. Now I have a question for you. Let's say there is no unconformity in the map that I am showing you here, and you have some sort of a map here. I'm going to draw this thickness map. And I'm going to just write some values here. For example, let's say this is 100 meter, 110 meters, 120 meters, 130 meters. So where do you think is the depositional center? You have to tell me that. I have given you two locations, A and B. And in which direction do you think depositional center will be there? So you can unmute and give me your answers. Where do you think you'll have a which side will be the depositional center, A or B? Why B? So B, yeah, okay. So I'll explain it. You are correct. It has to be in this direction. Here, the thickness change is not much, but sometimes you can have a very drastic increase in thickness. So this will look something like this. So overall thickness is increasing in this direction. So this is more exaggerated here. So overall will be something like this. So thickness here is at A point, it is 100 meters, whereas here it is 130 meters. So this is a thickness map. It measures thickness between two strata. That is known as isopach map. Depth map is something else. Depth map, for example, if this is your ground level and this layer is here. So depth map will measure depth of a particular strata. For example, it can measure depth. It is deeper here, it is shallower here. But thickness map will measure the thickness that is between two strata. So this is the difference between depth map and isopach. So an isopach map shows aerial variation in thickness of a stratigraphic unit. It will provide you overall variation in the thickness of a stratigraphic unit. Now the second one, paleogeological maps or outcrop maps. So these are the maps showing geological units outcropping at an unconformity surface. They can be constructed from extensive outcrop or subsurface data. So what you do sort of circumstances, you pick up a surface, for example, an unconformity surface. So if you are creating an outcrop map, so then you will have to go to the field where some of the stratigraphic layers are exposed onto the surface. You study those layers, then you create outcrop map, or subcrop or subsurface maps will be created based on subsurface data, which in most cases is seismic data. And third type you have are worm's eye view maps. So these maps show the distribution of geological units that show overlapping relationship with an unconformity. So what do you mean? So distribution of geological units overlapping relation with an unconformity. So if you remember different types of truncations, stratigraphic truncations that you have seen. So let's say you have some sort of an unconformity surface. And what will be onlap? Onlap is if there is some steeply dipping surface, and let's say you could have some beds here which have been tilted because of this. So this is the, these are the strata underlying this unconformity. Then you can have some strata which are onlapping. Onlapping means they will have gentler dip compared to this unconformity surface. So something like this. So this type of truncation you all already seen is known as onlap. So I'll mention this as onlap, and this is unconformity, and these are the underlying strata. So what you'll have here is that distribution of these geological units. So you can have different geological units here. Let's say this is one unit, and you can have another unit here, other units, these alternating sand shield units you can have here, and distribution of these units onlapping onto unconformity surfaces, these are known as worm's eye view maps. Their main use is to illustrate the pattern of basin fill, shifting shorelines, or gradual burial of a pre-existing erosional topography. So this unconformity, for example, in this case is showing a pre-existing erosional topography, how it is getting buried. How it will show? Because in this case you have sediments which are first depositing up to this level 1, then second, then third, then fourth, and then fifth. So overall you can see that maybe some sea level is rising, which is filling this unconformity surface. And shoreline shifting also it can show you, these overlapping surfaces. Because you have already studied in sequence stratigraphy, if you have some surfaces like this which are overlapping onto another surface, they can tell you what what is the direction of shoreline in which it is shifting. Which in the example that I have drawn here, the shoreline is shifting in this direction. So these type of maps will be known as worm's eye view maps. Then finally, you have the lithofacies map, which is, as the word suggests, they give you, litho means your rock types, and facies, what type of facies you have. So distribution of sediment types being deposited at that time. For construction of lithofacies map, thin stratigraphic units are preferred. So these are nothing. For these lithofacies maps will look something like this. So for example, you can have, you can say, okay, this is my area where you have these sand units, sands. These could be sand lobes here. For example, now these are surrounded by shale layers. So these type of maps, they are known as lithofacies maps. So you can have sand, and you, here it is shale. So you are not including like what is depth, what is thickness here. Of course, you can overlay other type of maps on these, but these types of maps, you will, these are known as lithofacies maps. In which area I am finding which rock type. Then next type, the, how many have we covered? Four. So the fifth type is multi-component ratio maps. So these maps record computation of sand shale ratio and clastic ratio. For example, if you have limestone as well as clastics, so you can say what proportion of the total thickness is limestone or what proportion of total thickness is carbonate. Now example of these will be, for example, you can have an area in three dimensions. So let's say, you have different types of layers here. And within these layers, I will say some of them could be sand layers, and some of them, maybe within the sand you have some shale present. Right, and this could be predominantly a shale layer. So, and then you can again have some sand here. This could be sand. And let's say this is all becomes shaley here. So these types of maps, if you are drawing them, and let's say in this direction, these units truncate. And what you see here, it's mostly shale. And then you can have some units here, for example, here you'll have some shales, and rest of it is, oh, sorry. You can have some shales and rest of it could be sand. It's like this. Similarly, this unit mostly you're seeing shale here. So if we construct this sort of a map, so map will be, you can take values at different points, such as you take value at point A. So overall thickness, if something is passing through point A, then similarly you can have something which is passing through this point B, and you take these readings at different points C, then you can have some readings at point D. So like this, you'll take readings at many points. So you'll record, so for example, if you look here, so sand shale ratio, sand over shale in this region will be somewhere around what? Maybe you have 1, 2, 3 out of 4 is sand. So sand shale ratio is, for example, 75% in this case, or you can write it as 0.75. But if you take the same reading, let's say at this point. So what will be sand shell ratio? There is no sand there or at that point. So sand shell ratio is 0 over here. Then similarly, you can have some point here. Here it will be sand shell ratio. So sand shell ratio at this point, now you see mostly it is shale. So you have this two layers of shale and maybe small sand here. So it is maybe let's say 0.25 or 25% at this point. So we have like 0.1 here, which is mostly sandy, then 0.2 here, which is 100% shale, and then 0.3 here, which is mostly shale. So if you are to construct a map of this, and let's say this is your north direction, so how will it look? So it may look something like this. So you'll have some sort of a contour here where sand thickness is increasing towards this direction, something like this. So for example, you can have a contour here. So what will be the first contour here? Let's say this is 0.75. Then you can have somewhere 0.5, then 0.25, and then this could be a line where it becomes almost zero. So that is what you're seeing here. So it means the points within this zone here, they are mostly sandy, and the points in that other zone that you see at the end here, so this is mostly shale. So this area is mostly shale, and in the middle you see some areas which are part sandy and part shaley. So these areas are part sandy, part shaley. So these type of maps are known as sand shale ratio maps. So these are different. So similarly, ratio you can take of anything. You can take clastic to carbonate ratios. So these are some of the examples of what type of ratios you can take. So clastic ratio is defined as rate of total cumulative thickness of clastic deposited to thickness of non-clastic. Non-clastic, for example, limestone, dolomite, evaporite, coal, these are all non-clastics. Whereas conglomerate, sandstone and mudstone, these will come under clastic. Similarly, you can have sand shale ratio maps, net thickness, gross thickness maps, these type of maps. The sixth map will be paleocurrent maps. These are the maps showing directions of paleocurrents in the basin at that time. So you have already studied paleocurrent indicators. So you'll go to an area, record all the paleocurrent indicators at different places, and you'll form some sort of a map like this. And in that map, you can say, okay, my paleocurrent direction in this area, I'm making some recordings here, and this is my paleocurrent direction. And then maybe later on at some other places, you're seeing some other direction, and it could be a different direction at some other places. So these paleocurrent maps will help in paleogeographic reconstructions. Now the last one are grain size maps. These maps show aerial distribution of sedimentary grain size. So this is especially useful for basins dominated by conglomerates. So you are just recording grain size. So you have taken, for example, cores from different areas in a sedimentary basin. You record those cores, you place them laterally based on the exact locations from where they were recorded, and then you can contour those maps to form grain size maps. Finally, after maps, the second point was cross sections. So there are two types of cross sections: master cross sections and stratigraphic sections. So master sections are, these are cross sections that show detailed geometry and sedimentary fill. So they will show the overall geometry and sedimentary fill, whereas stratigraphic cross sections show the time correlation of all major rock units along some generalized traverse along the basin. Such a section includes hiatuses during which there was no deposition or erosion. So these hiatuses are basically your unconformities. So master cross sections, they will provide you geometry as well as sedimentary fill of the whole basin. Whereas stratigraphic sections, they will correlate time units. For example, what you can have if you are looking at a master cross section or a stratigraphic cross section of a rift basin, you can have something like this, where it shows the basement faults, where it is these faults, and then you can have this another side. So this fault is going down, and then these will be filled with sediment. So what will start earlier, you may in the initial setting, you may have early rift sediments. So this will be early rift will be mostly continental and lacustrine and fluvial deposits. As the rift keeps on expanding, you may have basin fill deposits. For example, you can have turbidites during this time, and then there could be, for example, there is some sort of unconformity on top of this, then you can have an unconformity, and these sediments later on you can get later sediments deposited here like this. So this is a basin fill history. Another type example will be, for example, if you have, again, let's consider a rift basin only. So here in this, there is very little evidence of tectonics. Now, for example, if I give you that you have a rift basin in which rock units look something like this. So you see there is evidence of, and then there could be faults here also within these rocks, outside those basement faults. Then maybe you have some unconformity here, and then later on rocks could be deposited at an angle to these rocks, and then because these are at an angle, there has to be another unconformity, and then you can have some evidence of, say, now because the rift is gone, you can have other types of rock units which are also further, and then you can have another unconformity. This will be an unconformity. And then final, in the final stage, you can have again different rock types. For example, now you can have a passive margin where you are seeing this deltaic sediments later on. So for example, something. So these you can have then progradation cycles here. This is a passive margin setting. So you see different units. So all these unconformities, so you can correlate them with different basin history. So initially all these rocks were deposited horizontally, but they got tilted due to some tectonic activity. So this is an example of a geological or a cross section that you study for basin analysis. So what type of sediments you see? So normally you'll call these as, maybe these are early rift, continental. Then maybe as rift progressed, you may have some mid rift, shallow sediments, or you instead of it, let's say rift climax. Within this example, rift climax, shallow, marine to deep marine. Then after that, you can have some late rift. After this unconformity, and finally you have these passive margin sediments. So you see, just by looking at these sedimentary patterns and different structures, paleocurrent indicators, you will be able to identify these different units that you may see in a sedimentary fill, and these you can identify based on these cross sections. So overall, this is a cross section. Another thing that is very important to note is vertical exaggeration. So vertical exaggeration is nothing, it's just that the scale that you use in the horizontal direction and in the vertical direction is different. So why do we use this? We use this because sedimentary basins can have a lateral extent which could be hundreds of kilometers, whereas thickness can be at max few kilometers, right? So lateral extent is a lot. So if you don't do vertical exaggeration, what will happen is everything will appear almost horizontal. So for example, delta prograde may look something like this without vertical exaggeration. So if there is no vertical exaggeration, if this unit is, let's say, 100 meter, same here will be horizontally also, it will be 100 meters. So it is very difficult to identify geometries if you have no vertical exaggeration. So normally what you do is when you make these cross sections, you take a horizontal scale which is larger than the vertical scale, or a vertical scale which is smaller than horizontal scale. For example, if you have this 10:1 vertical exaggeration, it means that the same distance that you are seeing here, this 100 meters, or let's keep it as now 1000 meters or 1 kilometer, if you take same distance vertically, it will only be 100 meters. So there is, this is 10:1 ratio. Why do we call it 10:1? So we call it 10:1 because vertically anything, if you have same distance here, you'll need to multiply it with 10 to get the same distance on horizontal scale. So now the same things that you're seeing here, they might appear something like this. So these can give you better indication of geometry. So you have a different scale here. So the same, for example, 1 centimeter in a cross section along horizontal line will denote 100 meters, and same 1 centimeter along vertical line will denote only 100 meters. So vertical exaggeration is a very important tool in basin, in these cross sections. So we are done with basin analysis.